Good morning, colleagues. Today I will share a genetic gain in cimet wheat germplasm for yield and other traits. Obregon Toluca shuttle breeding is known to most of you. After the launch of BGRI, we also expanded our shuttle breeding to include Kenya, which we call Mexico-Kenya shuttle breeding. The field sites which we use in Mexico or in Kenya have very distinct environments, distinct disease pressures. Both sites use two seasons per year for selection, and very strong selection pressure is applied in field for agronomic and disease resistance traits. Obregon continues to play key role for grain yield, phenotyping and selection, whether it's optimum environment or drought stress environment or heat stress, which can be created all side by side in the same fields. In the first year yield trial, we have been able to test around 9,000 entries every year nowadays. And of this, selected 1,000 are then promoted to the second year yield testing under this range of environment. And this has helped us promote much better lines in our international trials and nurseries. So the first stage when we could evaluate genetic gain is our stage one yield trials. And here I show the yield distribution of two cohorts of elite lines. The lines tested in 2014 had 82% mean yield compared to the Czech Bolog 100 variety, which was released in 2014. In the blue distribution lines is for the 2020 cohort, the most recent, which has mean yield of 91%. That's a shift of 9% in mean yield in 6 years. But at the same time, more importantly, this right-hand corner of the yield distribution curve is also important. And you will see the frequency of lines here have increased around tenfold from 1.6% to 10.7% in 2000. I am also using the data provided by our partners from the international trials. They grow each year. And in this case, I'm using 39th Elite Spring Wheat Yield Trial data, for which we obtained results from 88 very diverse locations worldwide. What you will see that compared to the local Czech, which we are putting here as 100% yield, there are over 70% lines have shown on the average yield superiority, not only with local Czechs, but also some are showing superiority to our best yielding entry in the somewhat recent SWIT trials, and we use them as checks. So you could see that there are lines which are performing even better than our own checks, and this is what you want to see. You could also see the yield performance in a region, for example, Northwestern Plain Zone region of India, or in a country of Afghanistan. So I'm just using some of the recent analysis, which show that at this regional level or country level, the genetic gain over the last 15 years have been around 119 or 124 kg per hectare per year, which translates to 3.3 to 3.8% per year. In case of Afghanistan, in this study, they also show that the partners are updating local checks over time. So local checks are also showing improved yield, as well as CIMIT checks are also improving for the yield, which is also very important for breeding. For UG99 resistance, now we have 13 variants in about 20 years since UG99 was detected. But for the breeding program, the genes like SR24, SR36, TMP, and 8156 were defeated in this time period, and they increased the susceptibility or made the lines which carried these genes susceptible in breeding materials. But despite this, we have now about 80% of the lines which we distribute through international trials and nurseries have high to moderate or adequate resistance level compared to 80% susceptibility when the work started in 2005. So it's a big change, as you could see. And a large proportion of lines have adult plant resistance, which is based on the combination of 3 to 5 minor genes, which is our target because of resistance durability. But also we have been able to introduce at least 8 race-specific resistance genes listed here in our elite gene pool. So there's been big genetic gain in regards to stem rust. Yellow rust has also not been silent at this time. As you could see, that aggressive races have evolved and they migrated to different parts of the world. From 2000 onwards, yellow rust has become very important disease in many countries of Asia, Africa, even in North America and South America, and of course, Europe. PST11 lineage from Afghanistan moved to Ethiopia in 2016 and 2018 became most important race. And also local evolution has been occurring every place. Like in Mexico, many genes broke down since the incursion of PSTS1. But because we have also upscaled our phenotyping work in India as well as maintained in Kenya, we have been able to select a much higher proportion of elite lines which have very high to adequate level of resistance with less than 20% disease severity under high disease pressure. So good genetic gain still continues to be made. The new disease, wheat blast for Asia, a few years back identified in Bangladesh. What we are finding through GWAS study, the YR17 carrying translocation on chromosome 2A, commonly called 2NS translocation, is the main source of resistance. There are some other QTLs, but not so important depending on the phenotyping year or environment. And the interesting part is this 2NS translocation now is present in almost, you could call, fixed state, or in 94% of the IBWSN and Southern nursery. Important to our national partners is the varieties which are released. And in the last 5 years or so, over 150 varieties have been released by 22 partner countries listed here. That is about 25 new varieties per year. That's a very significant change. You will see that how new varieties are being released by national partners, which will enhance grain yields in farmers' fields. Finally, a new project which is now replacing the DGGW project is called AGG. And this project will operate for the next 5 years, and it will continue supporting climate resilient, nutritious, efficient, productive varieties development based on product profiles. It will keep putting scientific lens on breeding methods for the more faster and more efficient cultivar development, gender and social equity intentionality, and capacity development, individual and institutional. These are the core primary objectives of the new project supported by the same donors and some new donors. Finally, I like to acknowledge all the donor agencies, the foundations of, through various different projects, which continue to support the CIMIC breeding work, the governments, as well as farmers organization which supports Cimet wheat breeding. Thank you very much.